Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So let's begin this video. But before that, let me inform you that you can download the PDF of this session via the Telegram channel of ours. The link of the channel is in description below. So the very first question is, India has announced to start exports of mangoes and pomegranate to the US from January, February to boost India's exports of agri products. This is done under the framework agreement for implementing the 2-2 agri market access issues. Which two US products are allowed entry into the Indian market under this agreement? So guys, here the right answer is option A, cherries and alfalfa hay. So basically, as the name itself is very indicative of the purpose for which this agreement was signed, the basic thing that you need to remember from this agreement is the products that are allowed entry in the US market as well as the US products that are allowed entry in the Indian market. For here, the US products that are that have gained entry in the Indian market are cherries and alfalfa hay, whereas India's products that have gained entry in the US market are mangoes and pomegranate. Now, this agreement was signed in the month of November 2021 when the meeting of India and US was held. So let's look into the organizations or the departments which have signed this agreement as well as the meeting itself. So it was the 12th India-US Trade Policy Forum meeting that was held in November, and during that meeting, Department of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare of India and US Department of Agriculture have signed this 2-2 agri market access issues agreement. Now, this much is sufficient from the exam point of view. Now, let's move on to the next question. At which institute has IRDAI established the motor insurance hub? So let me give you the brief about this news itself, then we will discuss the answer. So recently, the Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India has established two hubs. One is the motor insurance hub and second one is the property insurance hub. So both of these hubs have been established at two different institutes. The motor insurance hub has been established at Institute of Insurance and Risk Management, whereas the property insurance hub has been established at the National Insurance Academy. Now, the purpose of these two insurance hubs are basically in order to reduce the losses that are incurred by the general insurance companies in the motor vehicle segment as well as in the property insurance segment. These hubs have been established by the IRDAI. Now, you must raise a question. Why are these companies incurring losses in the motor vehicle as well as property insurance segments? So now the answer to this question is that at present, the general insurance companies that are engaged in the motor vehicle as well as property insurance segments do not follow a uniform and standardized risk report format. Okay. If any claim is to be settled, for that an inspection report is prepared by the insurance company in order to check the damage done to the property or the motor vehicle in order to settle claim against that vehicle or that property. Now, for that, the inspection report or the risk survey report that is prepared. So that report is not prepared according to a standardized format, and that leads to the losses to these companies. And in order to reduce the losses, these two hubs have been established. Now, apart from these two hubs, an advisory committee has also been set up by the IRDAI. So let's discuss about the advisory committees as well. So this committee is going to have two subcommittees. One will be the motor insurance committee and the other one will be the property insurance subcommittee. The head of this advisory committee will be the chairperson of the, basically the director of the National Insurance Academy. Okay. The basic purpose of the motor insurance subcommittee is to develop guidelines on inspection of the vehicles, standard operating processes to be followed by the vehicle owners in the event of loss. And the purpose of this second subcommittee that will look into the property insurance segment is to create a repository of the past risk inspection reports as well as develop standard survey and inspection report format so that the companies would not incur huge losses in these segments. Now, the third question is, what is the new limit for banks set up by RBI for maintaining the liquidity coverage ratio on deposits and other extension of funds received from the non-financial small business customers. So guys, here the right answer is rupees 7.5 crores. Earlier the limit was rupees 5 crores. Now this limit has been increased for a specific segment of deposits that are coming from the non-financial small business customers. Not all the deposits that the banks receive. Okay, so do remember this thing. Now, what is the liquidity coverage ratio? So, liquidity coverage ratio basically tells us about the liquidity that the bank has in comparison to its risky assets or against the risky assets. So, that is what the liquidity coverage ratio states. Okay, so the RBI has increased this LCR for banks. Now, this is applicable on which banks? So, that we need to discuss here. Okay. So, it is applicable to all commercial banks except regional rural banks, local area banks and payment banks. Okay. So, the commercial banks that are taking deposits and the other kind of funds from the non-financial small business customers, they need to keep an LCR of rupees 7.5 crore. Earlier, this limit was 5 crore. Now, the purpose of increasing this limit is to help the banks manage their risk, liquidity risk, and also to align the RBI's policies with the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision Standards. Okay. Now, guys, from SEBI's perspective, this question is very, very important. Okay. Now, I hope that you are aware about this Basel Committee on Banking Supervision Standards, because that too, again, is a very important part of your finance. Okay. So, do prepare this thing. Finance or banking, well, a segment that comes in your RBI and SEBI exam. So, this is a part of that portion, and I hope that you all have covered it. And even if you haven't covered it, so we have prepared the PDF for this. So, it is mentioned in the PDF. You can cover it from that there also. Moving ahead, which company has received the contract for the second phase of the Passport Seva program? So, here the right answer is Tata Consultancy Services. So, Passport Seva program was launched in 2008 in order to digitalize the services related to the passports. Now, in the second phase of this program, basically the technology will be leveraged, okay? Because the basic purpose of launching this program was to use the digital technology. So, what is the intention of launching a second phase when the basic purpose of the first phase was also to digitize the passport related services? So the intention of launching the second phase is to leverage the technology to enhance the customer experience. Okay. So as we can see that many technologies are emerging nowadays, and in order to incorporate those technologies within this program, this second phase has been launched. Now do remember, TCS is the implementing agency of this program in the first phase also and in the second phase also. Moving ahead, India and Indonesia have announced to boost connectivity between Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Ace province of Indonesia. Which port of Indonesia will be developed under this collaboration? So, here the right answer is Sabang Port. Okay, so this is located in the Ace province, and the basic purpose of this collaboration, which is under development since 2018, basically under planning, we can say, since 2018. Okay, so India is planning to boost the connectivity between the Andaman and Nicobar Islands as well as the Ace province of Indonesia. And under this collaboration, this port, which is located at a very strategic location, and that strategic location is the entrance of the Strait of Malacca. Okay, so if India is helping Indonesia to develop the infrastructure of this port and overall development, then this will lead to a boost in the mutual relations of India and Indonesia, and also help India geostrategically as well. Because I hope that you are aware that the Strait of Malacca is of the most importance for China, because majority of China's oil and the fuel comes from this Strait of Malacca. Okay, so if India is having a greater position at this location, then it will be of benefit for India only. Okay. Now, the Sabang port is located at a distance of 90 nautical miles away from Andaman and Nicobar. So, that's a very basic information that you need to be aware of. Moving ahead, what is the venue of India's first multidimensional adventure sports expedition? First of all, let me inform you that it has already been held in November 2021. Right now, the Defense Minister of India has welcomed the players. Now the venue is France. So this was conducted by the National Institute of Mountaineering and Allied Services, Allied Sports in France, and the team of India was led by director of this institution, Colonel Sarfaraz Singh, comprising 12 people. So the team was comprised of 12 people, 8 army people and 4 youth from the Arunachal Pradesh. Next question is, which state celebrate Lusung festival, also known as Namsung festival? So it is Sikkim. Guys, state festivals are very important. They can be asked in your examination. Okay. So Sikkim celebrates this Lusung festival, or also known as Namsung festival, as a harvest festival. Okay. So it's a harvest festival of Sikkim, and it is celebrated in the 10th month of the Tibetan lunar calendar. Do prepare this point as well. Okay. Next is that the Lusung festival is also known as Sonam Lusung, and it is celebrated as such by the Sikkimese Bhutia. Bhutia is a tribe. Namsung is celebrated by Lepchas. Okay. And it is also celebrated in Nepal and Bhutan. So that's also an important point. Now is the time for the last question of the day. So which two northeastern states are being connected with the Jan Shatabdi Express? So here the right answer is Tripura and Manipur. So Agartala in Tripura and Jiribam in Manipur. These two places are being connected with the Jan Shatabdi Express. Now apart from this Jan Shatabdi Express, there are many other trains as well that run in the state of Tripura. So let's have a look at that. Rajdhani Express is there, Tripura Sundari is there, Kanchanjunga, Hamsafar Express, Sakandrabad Express, Deoghar Express, Rani Kamlapati Express and Silchar Agartala special train. Now guys, you need to know this thing, that the connectivity with the Northeast India is of greater importance to the entire Indian, basically. Now, why is this so? First of all, if the connectivity is boosted here, then tourism will get a boost. Secondly, industries will also be enticed to open their businesses here, because connectivity is one thing that works as a raw material for the industries. If connectivity is not there, how can they import or bring their raw material? So connectivity will boost the tourism, will boost the industrial revolution of the northeastern state, and thus it will create employment opportunities for the people living in the northeastern region, which will lead to their social development as well. So this is how the connectivity is important. Now there is a geostrategic importance attached to the connectivity of the northeast as well. Okay. Now here we have talked about the connectivity between Tripura and Manipur. Okay. The train that will run between Tripura and Manipur. But there is also a need to connect this entire northeastern region with the mainland. Now, as you can see that this is the only connectivity. Okay, this is the only region of connectivity between the northeastern state and the main India. Main India, I should not say this thing, the rest of India. Okay, so this is the chicken's neck or the Siliguri corridor, as we can say. So I hope that you are aware of this fact, that China is constantly aiming to break the connectivity between India and the Northeast India, because China has its policy of Tibet and its palms. Tibet and its fingers. Okay. Now I'm just giving you a glimpse about it. So what China says as its geostrategic policy, that Tibet is the palm, Ladakh, Nepal, Bhutan, Arunachal Pradesh and Sikkim are the five fingers that China aims to incorporate within its territory, like it has done with Tibet. Arunachal Pradesh to China claims as South Tibet. Okay, so Arunachal Pradesh is here, Sikkim is here. If China wants to grab these areas, it needs to cut the connectivity of India with the Northeast India, so that we cannot do any kind of war. We cannot just retaliate in time against China's expansionist policies, especially in Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh. So that's why connectivity with the northeastern region becomes all the more important. And what is India doing for that? So India has started the Kaladan multimodal project, through which we will go to Mizoram via Myanmar. I had discussed about this project in one of my previous classes also, so I'm not going into the details again, but I'm just informing you that how India is trying to boost its connectivity with the northeastern states. Okay, now guys, that's all for today. I hope that you have enjoyed the session for today. Thank you so much guys for watching it.